Welcome to evening prayer on Wednesday, the 28th of April. We're going to continue tonight looking at Psalm 95. But first, let's pray together. This is some words from the Bible, from the book of Chronicles. Yours, O Lord, are the greatness, the power, the glory, the victory, and the majesty. For all that is in the heavens and on the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord. And now, our God, we give thanks to you and praise your glorious name. We come before you, mighty God, maker of everything, maker of us. You are the potter and we are the clay. Help us to put ourselves willingly into your hands tonight. Help us to lean on you, to rely on you, to trust in you, to love you. Psalm 106 says, praise the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love lasts forever. We thank you, Jesus, that you have shown that love so clearly. And help us now to worship you and listen to you tonight, and in your name we pray. Amen. So we listen to Jason Silver's version of Psalm 95. We've got Mr. Suchet, Poirot himself. He's going to read to us a couple of times this week, bless him. And here is David Suchet reading Psalm 95.
Psalm 95. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. Today, if only you would hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did at Meribah, as you did that day at Massah in the wilderness, where your ancestors tested me. They tried me, though they had seen what I did. For 40 years I was angry with that generation. I said, they are a people whose hearts go astray, and they have not known my ways. So I declared on oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest.
A while ago, I had some investigation. I had a diagnosis of a heart complaint. Not, I hope, a very serious one, but nevertheless, I began to notice that I had this complaint. I didn't know that it was that at the time, but I began to notice something because I was having difficulty when I was going up hills. Do anyway, actually, but I was having more difficulty going up hills. A sign that the heart wasn't right. There are many images in the Bible to do with the heart. For example, you can have a fat heart. There we see in Psalm 119, their heart is covered with fat. People can have a closed heart. Psalm 17, they've closed their unfeeling heart, and with their mouth they speak proudly. You can have a proud heart, that's the lamp of the wicked. You can have a cold heart, as Matthew 24 says, the hearts of many people will become cold. You can have a hard heart, so that you can't see or hear God. Psalm 95 begins with praise, doesn't it? We talked about that last night. Ends with a warning. Don't harden your hearts, it says. In this book, The Heart of Christianity, sorry about the pun there. Marcus Borg, the author, writes in one of his chapters about opening the heart, and he has this paragraph, which I'll just read to you. He says, it's also interesting to reflect about what opens and closes our hearts on a daily basis. I am aware that some days my heart is more open than other days. Even in the course of a single day, there are moments where my heart is more open and more closed. Sometimes it's closed because of tiredness, worry, or busyness. I know that my heart is closed whenever I feel grumpy or self-preoccupied, or when the world looks ordinary, or when that critical voice is strong in my head, whether directed at myself or at others. When I stand in a supermarket checkout line and all the people I see look kind of ugly, I know that my heart is closed. Oh dear. Oh dear, oh dear. I think I may have done that last one. It's a sign, it's just a phrase that the Bible uses the word the heart, not to mean, as we do in these days, a sort of romantic thing or a feelings thing even, but us. The heart of us is us, the real us. That's our heart. And what the psalmist saying that said, start with praise, ends with a warning, don't harden your hearts, because that affects you as it can physically, as I was describing earlier, but it can also spiritually. If we become hard-hearted, where are we? We're going to pray. Bring the candle in. Let's pray for others and for ourselves, of course. Father God, we pray for those who've let themselves become bitter, hard-hearted, or cynical. It's an easy position to be in. It doesn't mean we have to love very much if we're hard. We pray that that may be ourselves, that you would change us, Lord. It does talk in your word about changing hearts of stone to give back hearts of flesh. We come to you asking for healing of sometimes even our personalities, that we, Lord, might be closer to you and therefore to other people. And help us when we meet such people to show love and care, that the heart may be melted and softened. And we sum up our prayers by praying the Lord's Prayer in the modern version of it, as we say together, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory, they're all yours, now and forever. Amen. Going to finish with a lovely song that Maggie Dawn wrote quite a few years back now, called My Heart Is Not Lifted Up Too High. And it's from Psalm 131, I think. And it just says, in simple trust, we bring our heart, our needs, ourselves, to lean like a child upon God. So we'll finish with this song, and I'll see you tomorrow when we'll turn to Psalm 22. Good night.
My heart. In this God shall